overall health. And so today we're talking about the prostate. Now, in order to kind of get caught up on where we are in this discussion, check out my previous video that talked about a fantastic supplement that not only helps with shrinking the prostate and reducing the prostate size, but also preventing hair loss. So today what we're going to get into is the number one nutrient that we find, if you happen to be deficient in it, can fuel prostate enlargement. So that's BPH, or benign prostatic hypertrophy, and eventually even we'll talk a little bit about prostate cancer. Now, the one thing that I want to let you know in advance is that I'm going to show you a very simple, easy way for you to tell if you are deficient in this nutrient, right? You don't even have to run out to the drugstore, to the lab. You don't have to call your doctor. You can test this at home to see if particularly you might be deficient in this and if it's something that you need to work on, all right? So let's just get into it. Now, I think the big thing to keep in mind is, well, you know, I always get the question, what does the prostate do, right? And how big is the prostate usually? So when we're thinking about what does the prostate do, prostate is really kind of an accessory sexual organ. It secretes prostatic fluid. So it is responsible for propelling semen and fluid from the seminal vesicles into the chamber, so into the urethra, so that it can actually be expelled. So it contributes to about 15 to 30% of the explosion that you have at the end of a sexual experience. Now, so the power of it becomes an important part of life, right? So I put together this little model here. And what I did is I wanted to show you that at the top of this, if you can imagine this is where your bladder sits, this little bally that I created is your prostate. And this tube is your urethra. Urethra is where the urine comes out of. So if you think about it like this, instead of those two-dimensional pictures that we keep showing you, if you think about it like this, then it starts to make sense how if this thing starts to get larger, it is going to cause your urethra, or the tube that your urine and the ejaculate come out of, it is going to cause it to clamp down, right? So that's a basic as to what the prostate does. So besides talking about what it does, I want to talk to you about what BPH is and how usually, what the size of the prostate usually is and all that great stuff. So the normal gland size is about 15 to 20 grams. So if your doctor tells you it's slightly enlarged or it's gotten enlarged, it's usually going to be a little larger than that. And that typically happens as time goes by. So what age does the prostate start to get bigger? I get this question all the time. Well, in the 40s is kind of when we start to notice that you're going to have a little bit of enlargement. And this enlargement can grow and can potentially block the urethra, right? So block this tube that the urine and the ejaculate is supposed to come out of. That's typically why we see the symptoms. Those same symptoms that we talk about when I ask, okay, are you going a lot at night? Are you having any trouble starting the flow? Are you having any trouble pushing it out? Are you getting up more than once a night to urinate? And so many of you will say, well, yeah, but I drink a lot of water. But typically, our urine pattern should not be interfering with sleep. Because if you know me, you know that I say that sleep is one of the most important things that we can do, particularly if we need to boost testosterone and just to be healthy and to overall just make things run smoother. So the interesting thing about the prostate is that as it starts to get larger, there's two different phases of enlargement. So the first phase of enlargement, it's increasing in the number of cells. So the cells are kind of dividing, multiplying, right? Phase two is more of an increase in the size of those cells, right? So we got an increase in volume of the cells, and then the cells increase in volume even more because now they're beginning they're getting fuller. They're swelling up, right? So when you think about it like that, and you think about the two phases, what we see is that when you're in your 50s, that whole process seems to start to really take off. So in the 40s is kind of when it starts, but in the 50s is where you start to notice a difference. I've even had some patients come to me and just say, "Doc, this all just seemed like it happened overnight. It almost happens like that." So with those two different phases of enlargement, The one, once you start to develop nodules or the cells start to get bigger, those cells really start to swell up. So I think it's important that you understand not only how that happens, why that happens, but also how that can actually be prevented. And what can we do in the meantime? So if you notice, last week we talked about DHT, and most importantly, we talked about saw palmetto. So if you haven't seen that video, I really want you to spend some time going back and looking at it. Because here's the thing, you may not have prostate issues now, but what I want to do is equip you with the tools necessary so that maybe you don't ever have prostate issues. Or if you have them now, you can go back to the doctor in 6 months to a year and look up, and the doctor's like, wow, your prostate is really shrinking. It's really improving in size. So that's why we're going to be going through small dialogues that pertain to BPH, the prostate, and even prostate cancer. Because by the time you're 70 or 80, more than 80 to 90% of men in Western developed countries, like the United States, typically have some enlarged prostate. And this topic is very near and dear to me, and if you follow me, you know why. So here's the thing about the prostate. Let's talk about how this even happens and how it starts to get big. Because everyone's saying, well, doc, you're telling me it's going to get big. Well, why? Okay, so why does the prostate start to get larger? Well, for two reasons. One, as those cells start to multiply, right, it's like anything else. We want the cells that multiply to die off and just keep going, right? So if cells keep growing, but they don't die off, a process called apoptosis, then we start to have problems. This is a problem we would have with any organ. Any organ that can, the cells regenerate and keep growing and keep growing, if they do not die off, then all of a sudden you look up and you're like, damn, why do I have so many cells around here, right? So that's one reason. And the other reason is cellular hyperplasia, which basically means those cells are actually getting bigger and they're swelling. I like the word swelling when we're talking about hyperplasia, right? So let's talk about why as time goes by, we have reduced cell death. Now, this is a picture of cell death. These cells are sitting there. Now you're noticing they're turning gray and they're dying off. Well, that's a good thing, because cells that replicate and divide and grow, but they don't get any, but they don't die off, those become a problem. So what fuels prostate enlargement? Well, we talked about DHT, right? Remember our conversation around DHT? The whole thing about DHT is that our process of DHT is basically testosterone gets converted over to DHT. DHT then creates a situation in the prostate where it's fueling inflammation, it's fueling prostate cells to grow and expand. And when we have a deficiency in the mineral that we're about to talk about next, that actually fuels the process of making it so that these cells, as they grow and expand, we need them to die, right? Because we need to keep making more. We need those ones to die off. They stop dying and just stay in this one space and keep enlarging and enlarging the situation and causing issues. So the first way that this happens is actually DHT, right? So the other way that this happens is something called, and you'll know it because you loaded up on it during this pandemic, right? What was the one thing that everybody was loading up on during the pandemic? We all loaded up on zinc. But unfortunately, so many of us have a zinc deficiency that it's actually fueling prostate enlargement in some gentlemen. So we'll talk about that in a second. But another thing that's going to fuel prostate enlargement is metabolic syndrome. So those of you who are pre-diabetic or even diabetic, the things that are happening in your body, insulin resistance, fuels the development and the enlargement of the cells, right? And then, of course, inflammation. We talk about it all the time. That's why I talk about antioxidants and what we can do to get inflammation down. That's why I push smoothie recipes and different natural substances that are going to decrease inflammation, decrease insulin resistance, and help us with this process of inflammation, because all of this fuels prostate enlargement. So when we're talking about the importance of the mineral that we're talking about, zinc, I want you to look at this. More than 16 studies have reported that zinc is markedly decreased in prostate cancer compared to normal and benign prostate tissue. And no study reported prostate cancer without a decrease in zinc levels so far. Now, this is from a study that I have dropped the link in below. And I put this in here because now that we've talking a little bit about benign prostatic hypertrophy or BPH, we have to start the dialogue a little bit about prostate cancer, because BPH puts you at an increased risk for prostate cancer. And the interesting thing about it is that when they study people who have BPH, people who have prostate cancer, one thing that is notably similar is the fact that they have a zinc deficiency. So you may be saying, well, doctor, I don't, because I've been taking zinc all 2 years, 2 years in a row. But you would be surprised, because depending on what type of zinc that you've been taking, depending on what form it is, whether or not your body was able to absorb that zinc, whether or not you were on acid blockers, whether or not, there's so many factors that go into whether or not the zinc was actually absorbed and used by your body correctly. That depends on whether or not you're depleted. So I'm going to actually show you a really quick and easy way that you can test to see whether or not you are zinc depleted or not. You don't have to ask your doctor, doc, can you run this test or anything like that. I've got a quick way for you to do it, and I'll show you that in a minute. But zinc ultimately becomes a really important thing, because without zinc, that whole process that I talked about cell death, you remember? Those cells are expanding and they're multiplying and they're dividing. We need them to die so that we can make more. But if they don't die, they stay in one place and keep replicating. And that is why zinc is so important. Zinc helps the process of apoptosis or cell death. And without that, we cannot, you know, have a prostate in a healthy space. Another thing that zinc does is it also helps citric acid accumulate in the prostate cells, which is really a really important part of the mitochondrial process. We talk about mitochondria sometimes. That's the powerhouse of the cell. So ultimately, that's why zinc is so darn important to the prostate. So if we take this conversation one step further, you have to ask yourself, you know, do I get enough zinc on a daily basis? And not only that, but is my body absorbing zinc? Now, if you happen to have an enlarged prostate already, you know, it happens, right? If you've lived past the age of 35 and you are having any type of erectile issues, or if you've ever had some issues where you notice a little pain when you're ejaculating, maybe you're having a weak stream or a delayed stream or having trouble pushing out the rest, or just some new issues that have popped up, it could potentially be prostate issues. So of course you want to get to your doctor and get a prostate exam, not just a PSA blood draw, but you also want to think about natural ways to combat this. In Austria, in Germany, they lean on nutraceuticals or plant substances before they go to the pharmaceutical industry. We are completely opposite here. We don't do that. So what I want to do is encourage you to have the tools necessary to take to your doctor and be like, doc, look, I read this. I printed this study out for you. Let's look at some other ways that we can do this, because oftentimes those medications create bigger issues than just a little prostate enlargement, okay? So on top of that, I want to remind you that if you get my ultimate stiffness bundle, while supplies last, you get a free prostate massager, because within the bundle is the ultimate guide to prostate massage. It also gives you the branded resources that I use with my own patients to help them shrink their prostate, right? So keep in mind, there are other ways to combat this than just the medication that your doctor puts you on. Or you can ask the doctor, hey, can we add this in with the medication that you've given me, okay? Now this slide here just really demonstrates the importance of zinc and how important it is to this process of apoptosis and making the prostate a healthy state. So now I want to make sure that we get to this part where I show you how to decide if you happen to have a zinc deficiency, even though you've been taking it, you know, because all zinc isn't created equally. You're not absorbing it the way that it could be. Some of your medication could be interfering with the zinc. So just because you're popping one every day does not mean that you have enough on board. So here's what I want you to do. Just go to the pharmacy and get some zinc. This one is zinc drink from Metagenics, right? You don't have to go Metagenics brand. You can get any zinc. And what you're going to do is you're going to take about 2 tablespoons and put it in a little cup, and you're going to take it and you're just going to swish it around in your mouth. You're going to throw it back like a shot, swish it around in your mouth. And I want you to note, now you have an optimal zinc level if immediately, as soon as you put it in your mouth, you're like, oh, this is terrible. You spit it out, right? You're like, oh my God, I need something else, right? You have an adequate zinc level. If you know, you notice it's a strong, unpleasant taste, but you don't really notice it after you either spit it out or swallow it, right? You are zinc deficient if you put that zinc on your tongue and it takes about 10 to 15 seconds, I'm sorry, before you even notice that it tastes bad, because it does, right? And then you are markedly zinc deficient, like super zinc deficient. If you just don't notice anything, you're like, gee, this tastes like water. That is a sign that you're zinc deficient, and that's a sign that zinc supplementation may be something that you want to do. All right. So I'm Dr. Rachael, and we do this every Thursday. We did it a little later today. It's kind of nice to see where you guys stand on it. Do you like it a little later like this? But every week we go live and our discussion is about how to help men optimize health. So subscribe to the channel, share this video with anyone that you think might find it useful. And of course, go back to last week's video, which actually really spends some time talking about DHT and how that impacts the prostate. So, hey, I'll see you next week. And next week, we will continue the conversation on that next supplement on my list for the top supplements for prostate function. All right? And also next week, I've got a special guest for you. I've got a gentleman who's had a journey on this process. His name is Ken. We're going to bring Ken on to kind of talk a little bit about his journey with erectile function issues and some of the mistakes he made. He really wants to share it because it was been quite a journey. He almost gave up several times and thought nothing was going to help, but we worked together and got things straightened out. So it's always a pleasure, and I'll see you next week.